presentation. And I'm going to introduce myself just a second.
So, Ronald will be the first speaker tonight. We'll talk about containers. The talk is set, I think. We'll have a break after his talk for 15 minutes, and then another talk from Peter, who will just sit Enjoy.
Thank you, Manu. So first of all, a quick disclaimer. I asked Manu about the timing. He told me 40 minutes, 40 minutes, and I said, okay, 1 hour. Then I prepared the slide, and then he said half an hour. So I will do my best so you can enjoy and have some takeaways from this presentation. So this presentation, as the title said, will be about containers and security in general. So we try to give a security wrap around the containers. What are the containers? How do we manage containers? What are the security considerations that we should take into account, and how we could help to improve the security of containers in production environment? But without giving specific recipes, but just talk about concept, because recipes are really tailored and are really specific for your environment, and each environment is so different that I cannot say here is the pure recipe that will work in any environment, of course. So the rest is open to discussion, and we have a questions, a Q&A session after, as soon as we have finished the 40 slides. So quick words, 2 words about me. So I'm Ronald. I know some of you because we have been colleagues together. I'm working in IT security for approximately 10 years, a bit more I think, but I stopped at 10 years because I don't want to count anymore. So I've had different responsibilities in different type of companies, so financial, insurance, telecom, and even pharma, which is it's all very interesting, of course. So now, lately I've been more involved, so earlier I was involved rather in vulnerability management, security assessment, reviewing design also, so it was a bit, all different type of responsibilities, but all always related to IT security, not really information security in general, but really IT security. So I come from the IT world, so you know that my view can be a bit, is subjective, okay? And you know what are my bias? Mm-hmm. All right. So here is the agenda. We'll have 4 parts. First one will be talk about the concept of containers, so you understand what's a container, the threats and vulnerabilities related to containers, see how we can mitigate and a few best practices. It will be only direction, so we'll just throw big arrows, and then you will have to continue look up on this topic. And a few takeaways. Don't worry, takeaways, just one slide, so the rest will take more time. So if you are at part 3 and still looking at your watch, then don't worry. There is some takeaways at the end, it's just one slide. So you can sleep and wake up at the 4th part, it would be great. Alright, so let's see what's Docker and what are containers on the current sea. So what is the concept, what is the concept behind containers actually? And when we talk about Docker, Docker is just an implementation of a container, a very popular implementation. But here we are talking, we will first start with the concept of containers, then we will move to Docker more specifically, because Docker is like, big and a pen. So I will be sometimes talking about big, which is a brand of a pen, and Docker is a brand of container. All right. So let's first start to see. Let's first give a few definitions. What are containers? Container is a way actually to isolate application, to isolate a process or even several processes, even though it's not recommended. In a particular, to isolate one process or one application from other application, other processes running on the same host, on the same entity. Okay. Also, very important, what bring container to the IT world is basically a way to package an application. Once that application is packaged, you should be able to run that packaged application in any type of system running the container engine. Right, and that's one of the biggest advantages. Making a portable unit that can be lifted by a crane tower, that can be dragged by a boat or over a truck, And then, yeah, that's globally the idea of containers. You see real containers like these ones can float by, can be tracked by a boat or even a truck, it doesn't really matter. It's what's inside is completely opaque to the external world. You are just shipping away applications. I read this one from this timeline from internet somewhere. The source is here, but it was taken from Aqua Security, which is well known in the security of container world, and they also ripped it off from another website. So I really no moral issue with that. So first of all, the containers, well, everybody's now talking about containers, already almost the past, and it's not the future, it's already present, about to be the past, I don't know. But the concept is very interesting and very important. Why? Because even if you don't know it, probably you have a few in your infrastructure running in production, or you have your developers which are knocking at your door and always saying, yeah, we want to have domain support. So can we maybe interrupt this? And does anybody knows exactly, have experience, lots of experience with Docker? Can maybe I do have a bit, okay? Anybody does anybody has no experience at all with don't know what I'm talking about. Okay. Seen in production already? Yeah? No hands. Yes, okay, but I see. Okay, so okay, good. Alright, it's not so new, containers. Actually, containers have existed in different types of operating systems. And here we will be only presenting the containers which are implemented in the Linux kernel, so in the Linux operating system. Don't tell Richard Stallman just what I've said because he will argue on the GNU, etc. For the Linux geeks, they know what I'm talking about. Anyway, so it all started like circa 2000. Actually, in BSD, you had the concept of JS, which were a bit more even advanced than the containers that we have currently in Linux. They were a bit more secure. In Linux, there was almost nothing. So Linux vServer Porter, along with Virtuoso and OpenVZ in those 5 years' time, these were not directly in the main, in the kernel directly. It was not in the in the kernel mainstream. It was a patch. So if you wanted to have basic container management, basic tooling around containers for Linux, you needed to patch your kernel. But then, and in 2008, Google came up with a patch that was submitted to the kernel and accepted by Linus Torvald, the old guru there, and it was merged into the kernel in 2008. And then LXC came and provided the basic tooling to enable the use of the C groups and namespaces, which are actually leveraged by LXC tools. So C groups is really the part that Google introduced in the kernel and that actually permitted the evolution of containers. And I will quickly draw a definition just after this slide of what exactly is a namespace, a C group, and you will understand why it enables containerization in the Linux kernel. And then Docker came in 2013, and we will see later on, just remember that it came in 2013. And it came with a rich framework intelligent litter of tools that would enable container management, actually. And that's just the success of Docker. So namespace and C groups. I will just draw a quick definition of namespace. So namespaces are actually a way in the kernel to enforce the isolation of resources. So you can say, for instance, I will run this process in namespace A, and run that other process, that other application in namespace B. Namespace A, the process in namespace A cannot see the information from the namespace B. All right, you have isolated the two. And you can also say, okay, I will create a file system namespace, and we share that with the process running in namespace A, right? You will also say that namespace will have a container stack, a network stack just for him, all right? That will be completely isolated from the other container which is running with his own network stack. And you can even say that that second container is not using his own network stack, he's using the network stack of the host, all right? But that could be a security flaw. what we will see later on why. You can also have isolated user space namespace, meaning that in my container with an isolated file system, I can create isolated an isolated set of users. Right? And you see the benefit there. Because if we mix that with the C groups that has been introduced, as I said, in 2008 by Google, you have a way, C groups is a way, also in the kernel, as I said, to limit the consumption of resources on your system. And so you can say, for instance, that process running in that namespace, I give him only half a CPU. I will only give him 1 gigabyte of memory. Right? And that's very interesting, because then if you mix the two, if you can isolate resource and if you can limit the resource that they can consume, you actually have something like a small virtual machine. Yeah. But that's completely wrong to say that. That's just to give you a better understanding of what we have there. And I will say why it's completely wrong what I've said, just to give you an idea. It's isolate resource, make them run autonomously, separated from other resources, and ensure that resource A does not impact resource in a namespace B. All right, now moving on to Docker. Docker is a container management toolbox. That's, I think, a good definition to put here. It brings a container runtime. The container runtime is actually the daemon, the services that will run the container, that will spin up containers. It will create the required namespace, it will create the required C groups, it will create the file system that is required for your container. Before that, in LXC, for instance, before Docker came up, you needed to create your own copy of the file system, make it put it in a subdirectory, and then do a chroot-like move. That was with LXC. Now, with Docker, you can build what we call container images. These container images are basically tar files which contains different layers, and each of these layers represents a stack of files. The next slide outlines it a bit more precisely. Docker enables you, as I said, to run images, and when you run an image, you have actually a container. So if I have to put the definition, the difference between an image and a container, an image is a static, a snapshot of a bunch of files that once instantiated become a container. It's like object instantiation if you have done some object oriented programming, sorry. So the Docker images are a standardized unit software it's a packaging which provides code of an application, well, compiled code, of course not code, because you cannot do anything with code, you can compile it, and its dependencies. And that's what is excellent, very interesting with Docker images. It's actually package it once, run everywhere. That's a bit, you remember the promise of Java, code once, run everywhere. We have the same for Docker, package once, run everywhere. Because of with this packaging unit, with these images, you can actually have something which is consistent and portable. The image, here is a 3D view, it's fancy, of a kernel, of a Docker image. That's one. And that's a second Docker image. Actually, when you create a Docker image, what you usually do is you use a parent image. And you will say, for instance, I will take an Ubuntu as a parent image. And in that Ubuntu image, you will have like the classical Ubuntu file that you will have, like the binaries, ls, cp, bash, etc. These will be provided directly with this image. So that's very easy, very convenient. And then based on this, you can say, oh, I want to add this file to that image. And then I want to add my Java application. Then I want also to add a JBoss server. And all these files will be stacked up in different layers, all right? Making an image made of different layers. Each of these layers is immutable. That's also important. And the last one is the one which is writable. And basically, you stack all your images, and the last one is where you will modify the files, is not persistent normally in the image. So the moment you instantiate the image, that one is blank, empty. You delete a few files, you stop your container, bathroom, but and spin it up again, the files that you have deleted are back again, right? Because this is not persistent, basically. You can make it persistent, of course. Huh? And that's why, actually, talking now about containers, we were talking about images, now we are talking about containers, which has, as I said, an instantiation of an image, or process running in an isolated environment. Containers should be ephemeral, should be stateless. And that's actually the initial best practice from Docker. Don't run containers with business data on it, or data that you need to recover. Actually, they will just provide, containers will just provide a service, all right? And you can, of course, have still persistency of your data, but then your application will need to communicate with a persistent layer, like a database, like a NFS term, like any type of persistent packet. But that's not the purpose of Docker containers. They should be ephemeral and stateless. That is like Frankenstein raised it as a baby, basically. Yeah, because as Frankenstein, you know, you will do you will do horrible stuff with your containers. You will apt get on it, you will add another application, you will debug stuff, and it will be horrible. But then, if you kill it and stage it again, it will be fresh like a newborn baby. Here is a few components of Docker. This you can find on the Docker on the Docker documentation. They present that's the Docker architecture. Anyway, it's a bit lightweight for an architect, but I'm not the author of this. But anyway, so you have different parts. You have the clients, you have the Docker host, and you have the registry. The clients enables you to build an image talking to a Docker daemon. And this image will be stored locally on the server where you build them or in a remote registry. And once you start an image, it will be a container and you do it by calling run. So let me show you. Maybe I can. Sorry, I just skipped that one. I wanted to show you this. Creating a container is as simple as this. I just create a Docker file, and the Docker file is this. I use the base images. This is the parent image. I start with the from. I could have put Ubuntu there, Debian, CentOS, whatever. JDK, so you also have basic image for Java developers, for Go developers, for whatever. Here I start with the Python image, and I said, okay, create a directory, then copy a file. And this is a file, it's a Flask application. Don't know if anybody of you knows Flask is just a small web server. It's a Python library that enables you to start an embedded web server. And then it returns the classical hello world. I know you like it. So I crafted that for you guys. And then I just install the requirements, the libraries, and then I can just start it. See? Build it. I just say, okay, now build that application and use the Docker file, which is in my local path, and you see, each of these lines, step 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, is building my image layers. And then I have an image, I have a Docker image. And then I can take that Docker image, put it on a USB drive, give it to Manu, and he will start it on his server at home, and it will work, right?
I will call you and say, why doesn't it work?
And it will be because of a typo you made in the command line. It's always a typo or a DNS issue. So, run it, it's as easy as this. Docker run, and then I said, well, expose that port, and then I went back to my browser and I got the fantastic hello world. So easy. That was an easy shot. But just to give you an idea, just with a single Docker file, you can create a full application. You can also have, like, you can use as a parent image instead of Python, you can say, JBoss, and then you just copy instead of a Python code, you copy a WAR file, and then you run it, and it will run, it will work, it's fantastic. I'm not selling Docker, I'm not employed by them, but it's really nice. Anyway, so here is the difference between containers and virtual machines. So I said, yeah, you can compare containers to virtual machines, but you should not say this, of course, because it's completely wrong. And actually, that was one of my motivations to make that talk, because I talked with a skilled developer, a friend, actually, with Java Architect. Nobody's perfect. And he told me, yeah, they want to move to a microservice-based architecture for all the application. I said, yeah, why not? And then he said, yeah, but they want to use containers for that. But each of these applications will have a small, will run into a small container and it will take lots of time. It's like booting up a virtual machine. I said, no, no, that's not that. Because it's completely different, of course. Different why? Because in the classical virtual machine setup, you have one machine on which you have an hypervisor which runs and will execute, will not execute, but will virtualize resources like CPU, memory, disks, network drivers, and on top of which you will install a guest operating system. In the container world, you don't have this. Although I said, yeah, you can use an Ubuntu image, but it doesn't mean that you have actually a kernel. Okay, you don't have the Linux kernel running on it. You just have a bunch of files which are typical for Unix, Ubuntu distribution. And this is actually the big difference. As you can see here, you have the host operating system, the Docker runtime, so that will spin up the containers. And here you have the application which are containerized. And actually, it also means something is that all of these applications, all of these containers, they share the same operating system, they share the same kernel here. Okay, they are not isolated. So we can safely say that actually containers are far from giving the same isolation guarantees that the virtualization gives today. All right. By the way, have you seen the point-to-one competition? They managed to make a host escape from an ES6 server. I found it great, yeah. Made them 50,000 Ks, I think. Anyway, 50 Ks as point. But anyway, I think it's also interesting to see that you will soon need to update and patch your ES6 servers. All right. Why is it so fancy and why everybody is talking about about Docker? I can already hear like, yeah, it exists in mainframe. We had LPaaS and of course LPaaS were much more secure than the containers. It gives an isolation mechanism which is far beyond what we have in Linux. Actually, it's just that Docker is so convenient, so easy to use that it was adopted quickly by developers. The tool set that has been given enables to change really the way you deploy, the way you do your test, the way you automate your test, the way you do CI/CD basically, continuous integration and continuous deployment. Because as I said, I can give a Docker image that I built to Manu. It also means that I can stage somewhere the Docker image, run it, and then do all my functional tests on it, my unit test on it, my operating test on it. I can do my Zap automated test, I can do my Dask testing, whatever. I can run application vulnerability scanner on it. It will be the exact same copy that I made up. All right? Okay. Is it clear for everybody? So that's part one. We are a bit late, but that's okay. It's expected. I gave that disclaimer. So now let's focus a bit on the attack surface. The sea was calm, but yeah, we loaded a bit too much on the we put too much on the shoulder of Docker maybe. Let's see what are the different points that could be interesting for the attack surface. When you deploy Docker, and actually you will never just deploy one Docker host. You perfectly know it, but I just want to show you the isolated world. And then of course in production you will have orchestrator, you will have lots of different stuff running on top. But here let's say that we have just one single machine, one operating system running on it, and one Docker engine. Of course, since you have seen that the operating system is shared, this would be a good target. Because if I'm running it here in a container, even though it's completely isolated, you can imagine that if I manage to exploit a vulnerability in the kernel, because I still share the kernel with other containers, then it's magic, I'm the king, okay? So that will be the first thing which will be interesting to dig into. The Docker engine is also interesting. You will have to ensure that you protect the access to the Docker engine. Why? Because actually, giving access to the Docker engine means you're giving a root to somebody. And that's one of the big issues with Docker today, is that you cannot give to your system admin access to Docker without giving them full, not system admin, but to a developer. I think that's a better example. You cannot give him access to the Docker socket or to the Docker API without giving him the full access to the system. All right. So giving access to Docker, remember this one, equals giving access to your full system as a root to your developers. What would be also interesting is to see that network here. We have two containers running on top of it. Can we by default jump out of there, go maybe here in the network driver of the host, or maybe go back in the container, the other container? Would be very interesting. I put a list of threats and vulnerabilities. I just put two threats, two type of threats, host abuse and container abuse, resource abuse more generically, and a few vulnerabilities corresponding to each of these threats. Of course, when you have host abuse and escape to host, then all the possible threats can be considered. How will you increase actually the probability to face that kind of threat? So escape to host, you know the escape to host, you're running in a container and you manage to pop out of it and have access to the full host, that you are king of the box. So first of all, you can, if you have poor container runtime isolation, basically you share a bit too, you are too friendly and you open the Docker API to everybody. That means you are really dead. I've seen a configuration where the Docker API was open, unauthenticated to the public world, and it was very generous, but then the customer had that issue because actually people were staging containers in its infrastructure, which was part of a botnet, and started to DDoS a campus in the US. So that's one of the risks. Poor container network isolation. Yeah, of course, if you don't isolate your container, you just run your container, but you will see that if you don't isolate it properly, it can access to the Docker host, it can also access other containers. And these are the stuff you want to avoid. What if now you manage to own an application which sits in a container, and then start to go from that application, running in a container, and manage to access the SSH daemon of the host, and then start to brute force it? You know the rest of the stuff. Unprotected runtime API is linked to the bad isolation of the runtime. Unpatched runtime container. 2 months ago, I think, a critical issue was found in Docker that would enable a malicious user to download, to pull, and run an image and have access to the underlying host. I think I showed this in a further slide. Unpatched kernel OS, of course, if you have an old kernel, an old OS, then it can be exploited. And unlimited resource assignment. If you have your application which is running in a container, I managed to exploit the application. And then if you haven't limited the resources which are available to the container, I could run a basic DOS on the host. Same goes for the container abuse. You can abuse vulnerability in the application. Of course, your vulnerability in the application won't magically disappear. And you should be cautious with using untrusted images. We will talk about this later. So I will speed up a bit now. So runtime isolation. Sometimes you'd like to use some specific flags. Some specific flags should really be avoided when you start up a container. I've seen this one, and that was also motivation. I saw an article, it was running Firefox in a container for more security, and the guy was using privilege. And it's very bad privilege, actually, because it means that if I own the Firefox, I can have full access to the underlying host. So it's a very dangerous switch. Sysadmin is also as dangerous as privilege. Here, for instance, you are not isolating the process. You're breaking the namespace of the process. Here you're running your application as root. You can, in a container, say that the container should run in with a specific user, and it's highly advised to do so. You don't forget 10 years of good practices, never run an application as root, although you will see that most of the containers are running as root. Also, you can mount volumes from the host. Can be also dangerous because I could mount the whole the whole file system of the host directly via access to the Docker socket. For container network isolation, now see, usually by default, you actually create a bridge that is connected to the host, and you can most probably by default access from container 2 to container 3, and also from container 2, 3, or 1, have access directly to the IP of the underlying interface. It's really funny. The IP of the bridge. And this is the kind of stuff you could do. Like if you have your Docker daemon running and open on that port, which is the unauthenticated port, there are no limits. Okay? You are basically root. If you can access that port on Docker, it's highly discouraged to do so. Never open that port, because of course, if anybody has access to it, he can do whatever he wants. Same could happen with SSH, of course. If you have on your host an SSH daemon running, which is probably the case, if you haven't isolated correctly your containers, basically with IP tables, you can have access directly there. Here you have a quick demo. It was a CVE 2019. Basically, it exploits a vulnerability in the Docker engine. So you could. It's a fun trick, actually, because it's difficult to explain without further slides, but just read that one, CVE 2019, and with that ID you will find it. It's a GIF, so I don't think I can open it more like this. But basically, the container, so the image is a malicious image that will trick the Docker engine to execute itself and overwrite itself, and then you have access to the host. Because you're using a shortcut in /procfs file, but that's a bit complex. But you can have a look. That's a recent CVE. It means that also you need to ensure that your runtime is patched. Same goes for your kernel, because as you have seen, the attack surface is shared here. All right. So if I manage to exploit the vulnerability here, and then I have a second stage vulnerability that exploits the vulnerability in the kernel, then we are done. Right. I took some CVE details from notes from CVE details. I just wanted to list out the CVEs from 2018 that were affecting Linux kernel, only the Linux kernel, and we have here a few some dates from 2017, but only published in 2018. It was also interesting to note that in 2017 we had much more issue. I think it was 40 or something like that. So you see, 2018 was generous for Linux. But then these issues are potentially exploitable for bouncing out of a container. Unlimited resource assignment, as I said, you can limit the resource that a new container should consume. Of course, containers will not make your application vulnerability magically disappear. Even if you have a vulnerability issue, don't say, yeah, it's running a container, nobody can do anything with that. Yes, of course, we can. Yes, we can. So, good practices still apply. Your application should be assessed, should be reviewed for vulnerabilities. Also, usage of untrusted image. Actually, in Docker, you have what we call the Docker Hub. Docker Hub is basically an open registry for all the Docker image. So there, I can find an image for Ubuntu, I can find an image for CentOS, for OpenJDK, for Golang, etc. But how can I trust these images? And indeed, I've seen that quite a few times, people are just pulling data from this Docker Hub. They're pulling images from Docker Hub without really validating what image they're actually pulling. And sometimes these images are just maintained by a community and sometimes by a user, simply one person. And I linked that topic, it's not directly related to Docker, but it could be the same threat could happen to Docker. Maybe you heard of it, it was I think 1 year ago, NPM node package was compromised. It was a community maintained package, but was in Cascade included as a dependency in a very used event streamer, that's the name of the package. The event streamer was downloaded daily by thousands of users, and it was using, and suddenly a new dependency came up in that node library. And actually, a malicious user managed to push in that dependency a malicious code, and all the users were affected. So basically, when you rely on a public repository which are maintained by communities, you don't always know what actually code you are running inside your organization. And that's something you should be careful about. Quickly. So part three, controls and mitigation. Here I wanted to a bit recenter the debate around the SDLC, so the software development lifecycle. And I put yes between brackets because it's always secure, of course, huh? The software development lifecycle. Why do we need to specify? And here, why do I say this? Because as security professionals, there is something interesting here. You will have to go back into the implementation phase. In the implementation phase, I don't say the deployment phase, okay? Let's make that difference clear. The implementation phase, where do you build the code, where you acquire the code, where you develop libraries, where you develop the solution. As a security professional, you will need to ensure that the building of this application is made in a secure way. Why? Because if you don't do so, it could jeopardize your test case, your functional test, because if you do it too late, like wrap your application in a Docker image with all the security layers that you want to add up to that Docker image and to your container, then it might be that the verification will fail later on. So at the implementation phase, you will need to have a close collaboration with the developers to make and to build that portable unit, to build that package in a secure way. Okay, because there you can still discuss with them and say, look, you have to use that particular configuration. You cannot run the Docker container without disabling all the capabilities by default and enabling this one. These are stuff you will need to discuss with them. You will also need to scan your containers, because as I said, you will be pulling images from Docker Hub, and you will have in that image other components which will be part of the ecosystem, like other binaries, like you will have OpenSSL, you will have an Apache server, not all the content of course, but at least you will have Apache, you will have OpenSSL, libc also that will be packaged in your container. And you need to scan it, because today you pull your image, you rely on that parent image, which has this version of OpenSSL, and tomorrow it's outdated, right? And then you need to ensure that the image that you are using are constantly scanned. For this, you have different tools. Huh? You have a tool from CoreOS, which has been bought by Red Hat, which has been bought by IBM. So CoreOS is, Claire is IBM. And Core is also a nice, solution, and you have also Aqua Microscanner and OpenSCAP. OpenSCAP, why do I put it here? Just because many people are putting it in their list, but I don't think it really fits. OpenSCAP is really a specification that is rather used for compliance reason, to assess the compliance of your machine. It's less fitted for actually scanning for vulnerabilities in containers. That's first, and second, it's also more adapted for Red Hat. Basically, the OpenSCAP policy that you currently have are more Red Hat focused. Open to discussion, but yeah.
And X-ray?
Sorry?
And X-ray?
X-ray, I don't know that one. Sorry. You are using it? You know it?
From X-ray from Redoscan.
Okay, yeah. Okay, so as I said, you have different solutions, but the idea is always the same. You have an engine which basically collects data from different feeds, CVE database, Red Hat, Python, advisories, Alpine, etc., and then put everything in a database. And then from there, you can use that engine to interface it with your CI/CD system, so the system that will build your application. You can say that will be part of your pipeline, for instance, your continuous integration pipeline. You can say, okay, I have that source code. So the usual, process will be something like this. You have the developers, the dangerous one that everybody fears with the local admin on their laptop. They are pushing code in Git. Once that code will be committed, it all depends on your workflow. Of course, I'm not saying that this workflow is the workflow, the ideal workflow, but it could be that they push to a certain branch or with a specific commit tag, and then all of a sudden Jenkins or GitLab CI, whatever, will pick up the code, the source code, compile it, and then we'll start to have fun with unit testing. So we will enter the CI/CD pipeline. You will start with unit testing. You will start with SAST also testing, so you know the static application security testing. So you have pretty beautiful engines like the AppScan from IBM, etc., that can do that for you. I'm not selling IBM stuff, far from that, but anyway. And then you can also add as another layer of security anchor scanner. Once your application is built, once your Docker container is built, that can scan your container and say, yeah, this is good, this is bad, and you can either fail it or make it pass. And once it's passed, you can publish your application in a registry. All right? Your application will be published as a Docker image in a registry where you have control. Of course, don't publish it on a public repository. It will be not ideal, let's say. All right? Docker container enable us to... I'm about to finish, don't worry. Docker containers could also be used, Docker images actually, Docker in general can be also used to reduce the attack surface. As I said, you can use as a parent image an Ubuntu-based image coming with all the binaries from Ubuntu. You end up, if you start your application in Ubuntu application, in an image like 900 megabytes. And if you use an alternative one like the Alpine is a small application, it's a stripped up distribution of a Docker image, you end up with 80 megabytes, something like this. So you see the ratio here, huh? You divide by 10 the size of your image. It also means you divide by 10 your attack surface. Here I'm simplifying, yeah, of course, it's not like this, but that's the idea. Also, doing one interesting project from Google is the distroless-based image. Just like distroless, you will find it. Docker has been not Docker, sorry, it's Google who made that project. You can build applications specifically, for instance, here for Go. They are building a Go application. Actually, that's a very interesting Docker file. But, I don't have time to go into details. But these distroless are really stripped off. Image, and you have almost nothing in it. You don't have bash, you don't have a shell, you have nothing, right? And you can also start from scratch, so you have nothing. What can you put there? A fully static compiled binary file. Okay, that works. And that's why Go is really the friend of Docker, because in Go it's easy to compile it and have a static application. All right, issue with that, with those minimal images, it's difficult to debug, so it's a trade-off here, right? If today your application is running, it's nice, it's secure, we have reduced the attack surface, there is nothing in the container. If somebody exploits my application, it doesn't have access to a bash, it doesn't have access to a possible vulnerable version of OpenSSL, nothing. But here you don't have access to it either. Huh? So if you have an application which is bugging, good luck. No, there are alternatives for this. For instance, in the distroless images, you can tag the images and you can use an image which will be tagged debug, and then it's shipped off with all debugging tools. And because your container are stateless, there is no problem to stage a new one and debug it, of course. Voilà. So another topic which is very important, and I will redirect it to Docker Content Trust, to the documentation of Docker Content Trust. You can, of course, use a different registry of Docker images. And you can, based on PGP keys, ensure that the image you're downloading are signed by somebody you trust. Alright? Because image can be signed and published signed in the Docker registry. And that should be enforced. Alright? And you can say, when you configure your Docker engine, you say, only use image which have been signed by a known party. Alright, that was for the build part. And for the run part, I have here a few recommendations quickly. We are about to close, I promise. Sorry, I also gave trainings for 5 days and I was talking even faster. Yeah, it's not always easy to follow one of my trainings, but anyway. basically, what we can say that containers are as secure as your operating system is patched, as your application has been tested against using the classical static analysis tool, dynamic analysis tool, vulnerability scanner. It's as secure as your network is correctly isolated, network policy is Kubernetes specific, perhaps. And of course, it doesn't. It also implies that you need to beef up your configuration with, for instance, you have some ADS anomaly detection system, Sysdig, which is very popular for sysadmin, and they are providing pretty nice tools. But they have a new project here, it's Falco, and it's basically detecting weird behavior, suspect behavior within happening within a container. And then it's locked. And of course, you have a CM, you have that big log server which is consolidating everything, and you are already collecting the application log, the system logs, and now you will collect the Docker logs plus the Falco logs, for instance, and consolidate that and make pretty rules into your QRadar, Splunk, Logstash, ELK stack. Right now. Okay. Here, a bit some recommendation also. Yeah, that's the most important thing I want to make, because otherwise we have to go much into details. If you give access to your Docker API, you give access to the root of the system, your root on the system, right? That's something you have to remember. So if the developer comes and says, yeah, I want to have access to Docker, and you make, okay, I make a sudo rule, for instance, and you just have access to Docker, you are screwed, all right? It's like, he can sudo su. He will not do that, but he will make it. He will have full access in another way around via Docker. Docker comes actually with lots of security primitives which are existing in the Linux kernel, making it more secure. And if you don't use these primitives, then of course the promise of container and isolation would be more difficult to hold. Linux capabilities, it's an old concept. It's broken down root authorization, basically. So you know that the root is almighty of the system, but you have also capabilities. So for instance, you can say I have an unprivileged user and I give him just the capability to mount the file system. And he will be able to do that, but not the rest. All right, that's possible with the capabilities. Docker, by default, drops most of the dangerous capabilities on the system. Why? Because, for instance, let's take one of the capabilities. If I run a Docker container running as root, and I give him the capabilities to load kernel modules, you know what will happen, huh? Of course. If I'm able to load a kernel module, a driver, meaning I will link code in the kernel, meaning I have access to the whole system, right? So I should avoid that. So I should avoid that. And how should I do that? I will disable these capabilities. By default, Docker made a significant work on this and disabled most dangerous capabilities. You can go further, but not sure it's useful. But never ever disable the capabilities. Allow all the capabilities. Sorry. There's also another concept which also is in the kernel and not very well known. It's the seccomp. Sorry. It's to paraphrase that as a metaphor, we can say that it's somehow the firewall between ring 3 and ring 0. You are all CISSP or 2B, and you know what's the difference, of course. Ring 0 is the hyper-privileged memory space where the kernel is running and has directly access to the driver, to the devices. It's the world that you should protect to avoid the full compromise of the system, of course. And the ring 3 is where you have your application running, Word, Excel, etc. So basically, Docker also makes a filter of all the dangerous syscalls that can be issued from a Docker container. And that makes a second layer of defense. And actually, it's very interesting because if you go in that URL, you will see that you have non-security even. As I said earlier, for 2008, we had eight high-risk issues for the Linux kernel, but some of these were non-issue. Because of what? Because you had these filters. If you disable those filters, actually you are completely exposed to these vulnerabilities. So that's why it's important to stick with those filters and never do this, of course. That's one example. But that basically disable SecComp. You can also bind and use kernel primitives like SELinux, AppArmor. It's a tool which helps you to generate AppArmor profile because it's complex to run. If SELinux, you know it, it enables you to isolate, to also to create a context for a process and isolate that process, and it's enabled by the kernel. It's an old patch from the NSA in the Linux kernel. It's overly complex, and I'm not sure that anybody actually runs it in production. I mean, real policies. Anybody running SELinux? I mean, real policies that are constraint full, that are okay, you cannot do anything. I've never seen it running properly. And of course, it's clear why, because it requires lots of experience to be security minded. And there you need a very strong collaboration between security operators and system administrators. And it's very complex to have that. I mean, to make it happen. All right, also ensure to put limits on any Docker container you stage, because otherwise it can be abused, and if abused, then you can consume the resource of the host and have a full impact on the rest. For, about to close, and here are some takeaways, too long didn't listen. So containers are already probably in the vein of your infrastructure and impacting the architecture of your development, the way you build application, the way you deploy. If it's not impacting it, then it should be considered, because of course Docker is not a unique solution that will transform the whole IT of your organization, but some part of it most probably, because your developer might want to move to a new software architectures, and I think the whole pipeline should be thought of. And in that pipeline, as a security professional, I think that you should be involved. Involved from the beginning, from the build, from the code, ensure that you have security control to control the code which is being produced with SAS tool, static application security testing. Then also, as I said earlier, scan the container, scan the Docker file, and penetration testing the later phase of the software development lifecycle, as we had outlined earlier. So, you should be involved, and also it does not exclude that at runtime the ops will just have to wait for the containers to be delivered to them and say, oh yeah, it's running, okay, it's secure, I guess. I mean, that's the developer fault if it's not secure. Of course, it should be reviewed at runtime, and you should do security monitoring at runtime to ensure that most of the best practices have been implemented. All right, beyond Docker, of course, Docker will not run standalone in your organization. You will probably need some container orchestrators that will make containers move from one node to the other. So if one node dies, it comes back to live on another node. This is the promise of Kubernetes that you might have heard about. So Kubernetes is just a container orchestrator. I've seen it in production. It's really powerful. Docker Swarm, it was the original promise to have it in the standard toolset. It's completely shipped in Docker. So you can bring two Docker hosts and three at least, and make a swarm, make a cluster. But it's not as popular as Kubernetes in production. It's mostly used for development. But anyway, you can have different experiences on this. GVisor, a project from Google to move part of the Ring 0 in Ring 3. And the idea would be, of course, to reduce the attack surface in the kernel and to have it shipped in the container. So if you exploit a vulnerability in the kernel side, it's only on your container. Kata container, that's very fun because they are not staging, so they will be orchestrating containers, but not staging purely Docker containers, but using QME, which brings a real virtual machine. Cloud native, I don't know why I put it, just because it's if I had a mustache, then I had to talk about it. No, a joke about Cloud native is just a big initiative. They consolidate different type of project. Have a look, it's very interesting. You have different projects that enables you to build container-based application, but it's not only container-based, but to build around that ecosystem, the applications that are built around that ecosystem, I mean the Docker ecosystem. I will breathe now. Thanks. Are there any questions?
Yes. Have you seen so far some Docker API integration with security product for, I don't know, IPS, antivirus, the kind of thing that you find in the VMware world with vCenter integration?
I haven't seen that. So basically, so the question is that, just to be sure that I understood correctly, so a product that will be able to be a gateway between antivirus engines and to be able to scan within containers
via the Docker API.
Via the Docker API? No, I haven't seen that.
A bit like VShield and Port or NSX, VMware, that kind of technologies.
No, not that at all. You can, not that I think of. You can, of course, you can analyze the content of the container and do matching against. For instance, if you have a collection of indicator of compromise with which are indexed by MD5 JSON, then you can find some indicator of compromise.
Of course,
that works. Yes, that this is possible, but I don't know.
Yeah. So far, the security is really in the container itself, right?
Yeah.
But not really like you find in the VMware world via the DA6.
No.
Not yet.
Yeah. There's some solutions to that.
I haven't
seen them working. Specifically for containers, and they cover the whole chain, including the software, the secure software, the environment software, also the runtime environments, scanning of malicious. For example, if a container turns out to be compromised or is known as malicious.
Yeah.
Can you say the name of the product?
Trend Micro.
Okay.
It's a bit like deep security for the VMware.
So usually the design is to be more solid with containers. Mm-hmm. Like with the company does, we drill down heavily in design for containers, because what you just said is also very difficult to look at. We use OpenShift. And that basically you have NAT when you arrive at the OpenShift host level. So if you don't go even look inside, it's a disaster. Mm-hmm. That's why you really have to beat down on your engineers or your developers.
Yeah.
Say like run everything with lower permission processes, use a dip set you just got because it's a disaster elsewise. Takes both these and everything else that you can do in front of your Docker host. Like offload everything with hash service, with hash checks to virus total, whatever scan you have. You really have to be happy on that way.
So, it will require much more maturity from the engineering team than now.
Yeah. Everyone knows projects, yes. It's a difficult one, but then on the other hand, if you see speed, you can spin up. If you're compromised, you can deploy for the. I'm talking 4,000 containers within 30 minutes for loss tests. That's also one of the recovery getting out of the doghouse.
Yeah.
It's all easy. So.
Huge for interesting security.
Goes back and forth.
We didn't talk specifically about Docker secrets.
Yes.
And I wanted to know also perhaps what is your security opinion, okay. Or is there already some big findings in that, because I think this will also become very popular some people.
So the Docker secrets is part of the Swarm. So we have a Swarm cluster, so you can indeed store in the cluster a secret. You have the same in Kubernetes, you can also create a secret and you store it like within. Within the cluster, it's encoded in Base64, so basically it's as secure as you give access to that to the Swarm or to the Docker cluster. It's not I will not say that. So you should it's not ideal to store secrets in that if you don't protect them carefully. One important thing to do, like for instance, when you are in the Kubernetes swarm, when you are in, or even in the swarm, you should never give access to this secret. So you can, like in Kubernetes, you can say this pod. So the pod is basically a few containers that are running, can be several, but anyway, they have basic access to the API, and one of the basic access, by default, you don't have access to secret, but you. Could happen that you give access to the secret. But if somebody has access as administrator to your cluster, he can read the secret, of course, so it's not. Yes, it will be part of the. If it's part of the solution, it's okay, but never store personal. So for this, because it's not a good answer that I'm giving here, there is an issue with the storing of secrets actually and using tokens and how can you get out of it. One of the possibility would be to use an external vault where you store the password, where you store keys, where you store certificates that can be pulled a bit like an HSM. Okay, not like an HSM, not with the same level of security. But for instance, we have Vault from HashiCorp, not making any marketing here again, but here you give your application a token and the application can then pull the vault and say, give me that secret. The advantage here is that at least you can recycle token, you can change token, you can identify have different tokens for each application, and you have auditing and you have tracing on that. So you know when a secret has been collected at least. Once it has been collected, once you detect an abnormal behavior on a secret or token that has been collected from the Vault API, then you have to raise an alarm, then you have to renew the keys, you have to renew the secret. That would be a best approach, I think. So you can use it, I would say you can use secret, but never store personal secret in it. As long as it's part of the solution meaning supported by the cluster, I think it's okay, but it should not be personal account, it should not be password, always tokens, maximum, because tokens can be renewed without really impacting the rest. Can be certificates also, it all depends on the risk involved by the secret you store also. But Vault is an alternative to have more control on actually the secret you store, for the application which are containerized and running in your orchestrator. Any other question? No? Then I will have a drink of water. Yeah, that's a good
question. So just a few repetitious slides, we want to try to memorize everything. Hopefully I filmed everything and I will publish it also. So